Hi, welcome to Bent TV. This is The Film Whisperers, where two movie nerds talk all things film through a contemporary lens. I'm Matt.
And I'm Saj. It's been a while since you said that, hasn't
it? I know, but it comes back. It's like a second language. Like, I just remembered it as soon as the camera started rolling. How have you been over the last 12 months?
Oh, yeah, you know, it has been a crazy year. I think everyone could attest to it. I'm not going to say the C word, and that's something that we're not going to talk about.
No, we're not.
No. But yes, have consumed heaps of media. What about you?
Yeah, it's been a wild time. Obviously, very hard for a lot of people. But hopefully, you know, the only way is up from here. however, I guess silver lining is that over the last 12 months, obviously being home for a lot of it, there was a lot of opportunities to watch movies.
So much. Yeah, I agree. And TV and, you know, and everything else.
Everything. Yeah. So basically, you just plan out your day, like a book in the morning, TV show during the day, movie at night. So in light of that, I thought today we might talk a little bit about like films of 2020, obviously being stuck at home for a lot of it. And we could look at, you know, what we really loved, what we thought wasn't that great, and maybe what was a surprise or a bit weird that we consumed while we were...
The WTF
kind of movies, yes.
Yeah.
But we'll start off with the positives. So,
Definitely.
Yeah, what would you say was your favourite film of the year?
Okay. Without a doubt, Promising Young Woman.
Okay.
Have you seen this?
Yes.
Okay. I thought it was executed amazingly well. The director of this film was a newcomer named Emerald Fennell. Mm-hmm. She is the actress that plays Camilla in The Crown, so I did not know that she directs as well, and this is probably one of her first films. Karen Mulligan is just exceptional.
Incredible,
The soundtrack was really good.
Oh my gosh, so like, sorry to interject, like the movie's incredible, but as soon as like Paris Hilton
Stars
is in the soundtrack, like you sold me. Like I was already kind of sold, but like that was enough.
For me, it was before that when in one of the first scenes, the Spice Girls start playing Become One.
Ah, that's right.
That's right, yeah. Anyway, look, I think the reason as to why I really like this film is it's because it's one of those films that make you think, and the whole concept of consent is explored in it really well. And, you know, I guess we're two queer people, so we'll never be in the position of a lot of those men in that film. But to be honest, like one of the things that my genuine thoughts were, it probably sucks to be a straight guy. You know, because what you consider consent now was very different 10 years ago. And this film is about exploring that. And, you know, it talks about, you know, the things that the guys did back in the day and how it comes to bite them in the ass now. So yeah, I just thought that was just it was fascinating, and if you know the subplot, which we can't go into because it's a spoiler, was just so amazingly executed. The cameos are just, you know, really, really good. And my favorite thing about this is, and I read this on IMDb trivia. Do you know why it's called Promising Young Woman?
That's a great question. I actually don't.
Okay. So apparently, Brock Turner, who was convicted of, he sexually, obviously he raped a woman on campus.
Is this college, like, and he's an athlete, right?
Exactly. Yeah. The way a lot of the American media constructed that story was they called him a promising young man.
Ah, got you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Ah, interesting. Yeah. That's a really good fun fact. I actually didn't know that.
So yeah, look, strongly recommend. Definitely one of the best films of the year. I actually went in hoping to like it, and I was not disappointed the slightest.
Yeah.
Okay, so enough about that.
And also just one other thing about that, which I loved as well, and I don't know if it must have been intentional, but I feel like some of the casting choices, so the men that Carey Mulligan's character encounters when she's going out to like the nightclubs and stuff like that, like the first, well, one of them is, you know, played by, oh my God, what's his name?
Adam Brody.
Adam Brody. And another one is, I think that guy that was in like Superbad or whatever, kind
Christopher
of dorky guy.
Class.
Yes.
Yep.
I feel like those were like deliberate casting choices, like these people that have previously played like the kind of the good guy, the nerdy kind of whatever.
So the whole thing apparently was a commentary on what is a good guy.
Yeah.
And I think, it's brilliant. You know, it's...
So many layers, like very clever.
So many layers. Well, what about you? What were your thoughts?
Yeah, my favourite film, I think, of last year, not I think, my favourite film of last year was Queen and Slim, which was just an incredible film. It's very rare that I see a movie at the start of a year that I really love and then it stays my favorite film for the entire year because obviously you see so much and then it gets overtaken. But I was just blown away. I think it was one of the first films I saw and it was before obviously everything happened with, you know, the C word. And so I just, yeah, I loved everything about it. I mean, it's like a kind of modern take on the kind of Bonnie and Clyde story, which in and of itself is quite interesting.
Yeah.
And they've obviously replaced the original people with, you know, African-American actors, but the subtext or kind of the themes in the film are a lot more political. So it like touches on police brutality and all these other kind of things. And there's obviously a love story, sweeping love story over that as well. And so it kind of like hits you in all the different places. Yeah. Like it's emotional and it's beautiful and it's heart-wrenching and, you know, I think I'm a big fan of socially conscious movies. But what I love is that the themes in the film were not, it's not like they were like spoon-feeding you, like, this is the lesson you need to learn. Like by watching it, you felt it. Like they didn't need to actually spell it out. Like you felt what they were trying to say, if that makes sense.
The trajectory from start to finish, it was just beautifully directed as well.
The pacing was great.
The acting was really, really good as well. I'm going to have to agree with you.
It's similar to Promising Young Woman. The soundtrack is really good too. Like there's one song in it from this UK artist called Tiana Major that I've honestly listened to for the last 12 months, at least 5 times a week, just because it's such a beautiful song. So similar to Promising, like soundtracks can obviously help in this movie.
100%.
In this one, I think it really did as well.
Yeah. So is there anything else that you've been consuming?
Yeah, I guess because we've been at home and I've been unable to do much else, we've been obviously consuming a lot of other kinds of media. And I'm not a big television watcher, but I watched quite a bit last year and I really loved We Are Who We Are. So it's a HBO series directed by Luca Guadagnino, who did Call Me By Your Name, the film, which more people will probably be familiar with. And the show is about like a young queer guy who moves with his two lesbian mums to Italy. And he
loves Italy, doesn't he?
Sorry? He does. You're right. Yeah. That's such a good point. Yeah. And he's kind of navigating high school and he meets this other young person who's grappling with their gender identity. And it's just like so beautifully shot. Like the performances are so real and authentic and the soundtrack's also really, really good. So that was another one that I really, really loved. How about yourself?
Well, my show is also HBO. It's Michaela Cole's I May Destroy You.
You've seen this.
Some of the topics that get explored in the TV show, I don't think I've ever seen another TV show talk about. It's really powerful. Every episode just gives you something to think about. Definitely probably more intense than We Are Who We Are, I'm guessing. So the premise of this TV show is a woman gets gang raped at the start of episode one, and she, you know, wakes up the next day. She just remembers bits and pieces. Mm-hmm. Her drink has been spiked. She knows that. And it's how she tries to trace back what happened. And every episode, it's not just about that, but there's a few side storylines about, you know, her being a writer and struggling to have ideas going. Mm. And anyway, I just thought that had got to be the best TV show for 2020 for
and
me.
And even beyond, I reckon, like, I just haven't seen anything like it that powerful, like, in quite a long time. And is it Michaela Cole?
Michaela Cole,
I know she has another show from before that called, like, Chewing Gum. I haven't really seen it, but it seemed like that's not a heavy show. That's more like a lighthearted comedy.
It's a 100% comedy. Yeah. So she's I'd never really seen her do much dramatic stuff. So there's another Netflix show that she did. Again, really serious before I May Destroy You. I cannot remember the name right now. But Chewing Gum is her first show. And it's...
Trajectory, like kind of going from something that's kind of like very much just a straightforward comedy or like just a straight up comedy to something that like has like, I mean, there's almost like bits of dark humor in I May Destroy You as well, but like there's just so many different layers and
she wrote both as well. And I think that's fascinating because, you know, she could write comedic stuff and, you know, dramatic stuff as well. So what was yours again? We Are Who We Are.
And I'm just looking for something on the small screen. Those are your choices. Yeah. And for films, Promising Young Woman and Queen and Slim are your best bets.
Yes.
But thank you for joining us here on Bent TV. This was The Film Whisperers, and we'll see you soon.